canyons in this construction, and people were moving around affect sound. But it was 1998, so we didn't have MAX-OSP yet, and actually it was pretty analog system. But most recently, we developed a lot of different sorts of sensors. The problem of classical thermic design, it's very easy, it's extremely easy technology. You have two oscillators. One oscillator is fixed, high frequency oscillator. The second higher oscillator could be tuned because of your body motions, because you have this resonant circuitry open for both. It's one plate, and the second plate, your body. And a slight change in frequency produced after non-linear mixing, audible frequency. If here we have a frequency about, well, let's say, 200 kHz, and there 200 kHz, and it could be detuned for several kilohertz, like 200 and 203, for example, kilohertz. Beating frequency 3 kilohertz, you can hear it. So we can easily changing slightly one oscillators change audible sound. But in this circuitry we have one oscillator, two oscillators, then this mixer. Each oscillator has capacitors, has a coil. In classical design, all those parts are very unstable. And most people, most of you who know Feynman already had this experience. You tune Feynman in like half an hour, you definitely need to tune it back. You put this antenna, you have one sound. You put that antenna, just cannot control because the system went completely out of tuning area, and you need to change coil, retune coil, or add some capacitor. I did a very easy thing, so I decided that why we need such a big, even small, but too big circuitry. In case the most recent technology give us a really precise possibility to tune, to measure frequency, and why we need this heterodynamic circuitry. So in new version of Feynman's, I call it digital Feynman's, I get rid of all of that, I just leave this part. And I measure the basic frequency of this oscillator, and using maximum speed or PD, so maximum speed PD, I can build precise enough system which really can control. And the most important, that now I don't need to think about any sort of tuning. So you see, better than. So, not so I connected to USB in the other version. I connected also to sound card. It could be two. With USB, I used Arduino. Most chipsets are Arduino based. In 1 month, we did this USB version of. Sensors which are near, I just love the system. Then you can add any sort of stuff as antenna. Antenna could be just like this one. Antenna could be any conductive stuff. For example, if you put this Christmas stuff as an antenna, you can play not this way, but for example, you can touch it. You can make different sorts of actions with it. If you use, for example, this Christmas stuff, I just love this Christmas stuff. I used them in installation in 2005 in Austria, in France, for sensors like that. I call them Vetro sensors. Vetro means wind in Russian. Any sort of airflow produce very strong effect on your pitch. And then you can measure again velocity, distance, also this way, and then direction of motion, and produce pretty complicated control of the sound or visual stuff. Very good to use different sorts of fabric. There are numerous sorts of fabric incorporating metal threads. This one was just a fabric where you can use it as a gloves. My wife actually wanted to insist, but we decided not to use it for this presentation, it's too short. She has some kind of jacket, sure. Also a very nice name of fabric, and it works very good as an antenna. So you can use special clothes as an antenna. It's not enough time to show, but just want to mention. that if you connect to this sensor your own body, so we have special bracelets, metal, your body becomes an antenna. With a classical framing, just not possible, because you have totally detuned system and you cannot play. In this case, it's okay. So it's not really stable and precise, but you can easily play with your partner. And not a big distance actually, but on this distance approximately, you can really change parameters. And if it is very sensitive on how you touch your partner, because different sorts of touches produce completely different results. So it's also possible to develop this system as a part of your body antenna. Any sort of plants, any sort of vegetables, because they contain water. It means that they have conductance. So you can really develop a lot of interesting performances and installations over this biological stuff. Water. Just that. May I play a small video?
Yeah.
Okay. In Moscow and abroad, I conduct workshops. It happens from time to time on this technology, on some parallel technologies, for example, laser monitoring, eavesdropping systems, which are really useful for music.
One short question. Mm-hmm. How exactly do you plug this vegetable, for example, to the USB box?
With me actually here, but you just use some pin,
yeah,
and connect.
Just a physical connection.
Yeah, positive. Just physical. You need physical connection with the conductive thing. It's a part of workshop. In Moscow last January. Okay, I'm not getting sound. Installation based on medical system. I don't know English name for that. If you make the system, you can produce medicine drops. Very precise. It's a kind of rhythm instrument, four elements, four sensors connected to two metal plates, which measure the movement of kind of like transmit from each other. No. They interact just because they also have a kind of network, so network change capacities, but not so much interaction in the high frequency range. You have a big, most problem and most important thing to think about ground, because they work with ground. So they're not transmitters, they're not receivers. It's a capacitor, and if you have a bad ground, ground loop, or for example, if I unplug power supply from this computer, the tuning will change extremely. So you always need to think about a very good ground. That's it.
What's the distance approximately in which sensor sense the what's the range of the
approximately it's easy to use a range of about 2 meters. But in some cases, I don't show this video now because we don't have enough time, but we did installations with a whole antenna hanging on the ceiling, and people put dance under this ball, and it covers the area approximately like 3 meters. It's really sensitive. In case no other metal disturbing stuff moving. If everything is stable, you can work with distance up to 3 meters, but not moving.
Are you marketing these?
What?
Are you selling them?
Well, this question, like everybody was discussing yesterday, of course, I think about production of those sensors. Mm-hmm. And I'm sure that they should be as cheap as possible. Because actually, like Arduino, it's a kind of, like we call it, installation tool. Somebody made this term yesterday. Installation kit. You can build like numerous systems based on this technology. So probably in a while.
But right now they're not, or do you publish the circuits? Or?
If you will check my website, you can find some circuitry, not of the most recent circuitry, because I just didn't have enough time for that. But probably also it will publish it, so you can find any other stuff.
Okay, I think we'll have a short break. Ken, I'm from Albuquerque, Mexico. There are actually, I think, 4 people in the Albuquerque, Santa Fe area releasing the new stuff in their junction. And I'm one of them. I used to use junction. I might start using the first version again sometime soon. But my website is here, and it looks a lot like that. So I thought I'd make a little picture so you know if you found the right place. Now, Lisa is, that's a little hard to see, but Lisa, you know, stands for live sampling. Is that a little better? Yeah. And I realized right before we started today that the setup I'm mostly going to talk about, I don't do any live audio sampling. I don't do a little live sequencing, but I don't do any live sampling. But I wanted to show you that the main reason I use Lisa is because of this band, which is called Out of Context. And what this is basically my notes about how I play in this band. All of these people I sample, with the exception of Dino, who's another Lisa user. He's the conductor of this group. There's a upright bass player who's picking his nose in this picture, and there's an actor who's from like a very sort of premier acting company called Theater Grotesco in Santa Fe, and he's giving me a finger. That's how you can tell which one he is. So he speaks text, and I sample it. The conductor, cellist, the cornet, bassoon, flute, electric bass. There's a drummer who wasn't there that day, and a singer, extended vocalist. So all of these people I have coming into Lisa, so I put them into a Mackie 1202 mixer and then route them into the Motu FireWire audio interface and then bring them into my setup. I have a little rolling back case. It's very nice. I didn't want to schlep it all the way from the United States. And into the used to be an iBook, which died in May, and so I got my new Intel MacBook, and I've seen no problems running all my setups in Lisa so far. So anyway, that's the group I use Lisa for live sampling. But what I want to talk about today mostly is, well, actually, Robert, can you tell me when do you open this up? Like 1 o'clock?
Yeah.
Perfect. Okay. I'll just keep this right here. And if I must.
Okay,
like at 5:00, can you? Okay. because I'll show a 3-minute video at the end, so I don't know. All right. So in May, well, I was asked to perform a show in May, and I started preparing for it maybe in late February, March, and I had big ideas and not a lot of time. But as a lot of people in the States right now, I have a lot of the political and world situation on my mind. And I thought, well, there's plenty of ugliness going on. I wonder what I can do to make something beautiful. And I had just done, the last several years, actually, several versions of a theater production about Billy the Kid. It's great. It's this beautiful theater piece, The Glorious and Bloodthirsty Billy the Kid, the Greatest Serial Killer of Our Time, a Wild West show in Cabaret. And it's set, you know, of course, in Billy the Kid's time, so in addition to writing things like saloon ballads, you know, I compose as a proper musician and all, too, I also had to create all these sound effects. So I had lots of gun sounds around. And I decided I wanted to use that gun sound as the basis for a piece and to try to make as many kind of beautiful sounds as I could. And some of the examples of things I ended up putting in Lisa. So then the other thing that's been on my mind for several years, although, you know, I'm not a student anymore, I have to work for a living, and I don't get to think about it a whole lot, so maybe this is very pedestrian in terms of my thinking about live performance, but not only did I study classical piano as a kid, but I also started a rock band when I was like 13, so that's 28 years ago. And I started thinking about, you know, what is it that makes a rock show so much more fun to go to? We see, you know, you have a performer so often who's sitting there like this for 30 minutes, making inscrutable little, I have a very vulgar expression, but I'll just go ahead and say it, I'm in Amsterdam, what the hell, clit pad music. It's a French, there's a French percussionist, Recoin, he came up with that term, which I think is very funny, you know. So anyway, you know, in a rock show, by comparison, when you got all this great stuff going on, the drummer is all sweating, and getting all crazy, and so it's very, very physical, it's athletic, I mean, it's wonderful to watch, there's so much going on. And also, there's a fair amount of risk. I don't know how many academic music concerts you've been to where they actually play a CD, my God. They play a CD. You know, you sit there like you're in your living room and they press play, and that's what they do. And what's really scandalous is I interviewed another composer recently for a radio show that I do, and she was telling me she does a lot of production of work, and that concerts will actually prefer a composer who hands them a CD because it's easier to set up. So you get programmed if you have a CD, whereas if you know, walk in with like Rick Wakeman, stacks of keyboards and crazy equipment, they won't touch it. But then, you know, physicality and risk, those are two things that I thought of a long time ago, but one thing that occurred to me more this year was that it's easier for the audience to engage with you if there's a clear relationship between something you're doing and the sound that is coming out as a result of that. And so, those were just, you know, kind of the concerns that were on my mind when I started developing the piece. So, where did that take me? Basically, I wanted to not touch the laptop during the performance and not look at it, if I could get away with that, and I did. I wanted to use the most physical controllers that I could afford. You know, I basically looked on eBay for used things and things that I could implement soon enough to meet the schedule. And what I ended up using was a drum pad controller. So it's a Drumcat DK10. It's maybe this big, and it's quite heavy, bulky. So I didn't print, but it has 10 rubber pads on it that you hit with your hands or with drumsticks, what have you. And then also a guitar type foot pedal that outputs MIDI, which again is this big, clunky, heavy thing on the floor, so you can stomp on it as you're playing here. And then I have Elisa's AirFX. Is anybody familiar with these? Yeah, they're a lot of fun. They're very simple. They do exactly what they're supposed to do. They do it very easily. So what I found is that I stuck it, say the drum pads are here, I stuck it on a gooseneck of this. So that as I'm sticking, I'm filtering the sounds that are coming out in rhythm to how I'm sticking, which is a lot of fun. And I also play in a very funny dance band called Useless Eaters, and that's a Kissinger reference, but I put it on the gooseneck here, and as I'm playing guitar, I can lean into it and cause effects, which is a lot more fun than tapping the pedal on the floor. So very, very, very physical, very active. So those are basically the components, and I programmed so that I could have as much control as possible in the Mesa. I controlled the drum pad to send each different of the main pads on its own channel, so that it had a discrete MIDI channel, a discrete voice there. And as you can see, the foot pedal, 10 pedals, these are just controllers, and then CC pedals. And so the setup I ended up with, much like here, my laptop, and then the drum pads are there, and you can barely see it because of the coloring of this picture, but the AirFX right there, so it's catching on the sticking motion of my left hand. And of course, a Captain America t-shirt, which I thought was very appropriate for a piece about guns and violence and so forth. Alright. So, yeah. So, I had to come up with how to get around these limitations, that I've only got 10 pads that output MIDI note ons and note offs, and I've got a guitar foot pedal, 10 foot switches, and 2 CC pedals. So what I did is various things, and like I say, none of them are like super brilliant, but they're all pretty effective. And I just really wanted to keep it simple, because I didn't want anything that I was doing to be too abstracted from what resulted. You know, if I did something, I wanted there to be a very clear relationship to the sound that happened after. So in addition to just, you know, the pads playing notes, I also did things like using the on velocity to control pitch or the start point of the sample zone. So in one case, I have a really long sample. It's actually something like 20 samples just concatenated end to end, but it's put in a single zone, and I control where I'm starting it by how hard I hit the pad. So I can get anything, you know, from A to Z just by how hard I hit the pad, and this gives me a lot of flexibility with one pad. You do that across all the pads, and you've got all kinds of stuff. And then I made some of the pads have multiple uses depending which section of the piece I was in. In some cases, they send controller data, and in other cases, they actually play back stuff that I had sequenced live earlier in the performance. The foot switches, you know, it's probably easier even to just look at the next slide, which I think will show you a picture of the mapping. It's pretty easy to interpret. And I found that as I was looking over the setup last night too, there was so much more even than I could have done in Mesa, because there's so many ways that you can combine effects. For example, in the snapshot window, you have multiple controllers mapped to different locations of the screen. By moving one foot pedal, I could affect a number of things. So that is the first movement of the piece. That's sort of my score, as it turned out. So the first and second movements of the piece, where if you, all you Lisa users, you recognize what I'm representing here. This is the snapshot window. Is it snapshot window, whatever, you know, the window. And this pedal moves me back and forth, and this pedal moves me up and down. And unless I sat down, of course, I can't do both at once, so I can't get, you know, diagonal movements, but I really wasn't so worried about that. So I was just standing and doing stuff as I played. These were set to trigger four different tracks of a simple MTR record. It's a MIDI record object in Max. And these are the snap set triggers for this. Yeah, that trigger the four corners of the snapshot window, and then this advances me to the next snapshot. So I'm doing a lot of sort of manipulation with my feet that the audience doesn't necessarily need to know about. So I didn't worry about there being that physical eye engagement of what I'm doing. I went ahead and put them down here, but up there, the things in yellow were the names of the samples. And you can see those top 51, 49, 72, 73, those are the playbacks of these 1, 2, 3, 4 that I sampled down here, that I sequenced down there, so that I'm able to trigger them. It made more sense to me to be able to start recording with my foot and then play it back and go on to other things with my hands. So I managed to squeeze a whole lot of the functionality out of those. And then in another section, I remapped these top guys to send CC data. And I was just talking to Frank, and I realized pretty much after I'd been rehearsing it that I could have used Lisa's activity mode of MIDI processing, so that if I, say, did a roll on the pad, I could output some sweep of data as opposed to just hitting it once. But what I did is create a Max object that, well, I'll demonstrate it. If I hit the pad very hard, it sends, like, if I hit the pad very soft, it just goes like this. In terms of, say, if this is a dial or whatnot. But, oh, there's my reminder to demo this out. I'm a little dense sometimes, so I have to, make things very clear to myself. So instead of dragging all the hardware here to Amsterdam, I basically created a simulator in Max MSP. So as I'm, you can see a little light. Set up to look like transport buttons. it's going to be the well-behaved one. Okay, so anyway, let me quickly, super quickly. So now I change to another preset, and then I move to the next snapset, and suddenly... So the video that I'm going to show is actually an example of a piece called Elevator Music. And all the sounds are elevator machinery. And it has a very pretty video. And so what I did when I performed it, I was very shy. I didn't want people looking at me. So I asked this wonderful video artist, Brian Kineski from the University of New Mexico, to give me 10 minutes of video. And I played along with it, with a combination of me playing and using remote controller, the thing that I showed you, all of this stuff. And this is an excerpt.
Thank you. It's an environment for organization of audio quanta. So small, well, small. Basically, we're trying to deal with data in a musical way. And I guess I could tell a little bit of background, how we started working on it, and what's more or less the idea. And then we'll show you a movie, and then do a little presentation of controller we're working with in collaboration with Stein and with Dan O'Prowl, who did a presentation yesterday. In general, this environment is, or the need for this environment came from the question how to control masses or large quantities of parameters, of musical parameters, which was a question of, I guess, both of us were dealing with in kind of different ways. We met in 2002 and started thinking about coming up with another way of looping at parameters, rather than using, say, one fader, two faders, three faders, and kind of try to control both of them with your hands, or using some sort of physical interface which allows you to consciously control, or to, let's say, rationally control a couple of parameters. We decided to kind of look at the parameter space. So what we're doing right now is placing those musical parameters, which at the moment are about 400. Actually, 400 times 3, so that's like 1,200 parameters.
It kind of comes also with this increasing processing power of the machines. So what if we do, like, give the data that's close to the maximum the machine can process, and then also
squeeze it out?
But since they both come from like kind of compositional background, both me studying the sonology and the art in the lens. So we kind of had this interest also from a compositional point of view, how can we use this compositional space that arouses in those 400 parameters, for instance, or how to organize them in interesting result structures that make interesting sound events. So immediately, like, the first thing we came up was kind of try to encode this amount of information in kind of a spatial context. So to organize the masses of those control parameters in a kind of three-dimensional objects, which we can then kind of process and transpose and transport, and then connect them to resulting sound events in a kind of very direct way, so that it's like for instance, tendency mass, which is kind of familiar term in Bertrand Russell. If you have one dimension is time, and then the other is kind of boundaries for the stochastic process to kind of iterate. So it's kind of extension of that idea, but then put it maybe in more dimensional, like in a more characteristic environment for human perception, so to say, like as a space being a very, very familiar notion for all of us. So what maybe we'll start with just showing a very first kind of test with it, using this idea and connecting very simple things. Each entity in this environment represents one sine wave, and then the kind of position of an entity in this three-dimensional space, which just is mapped to a frequency, phase, and amplitude of each sine wave. So it's like
most simple setup you can think of. You just have 400,000 sine waves, or 250 in that case. Each one gets controlled by a point in the three-dimensional space.
So yeah, just a massive sense of stretch.
And that actually looks kind of it might look kind of let's say analog somehow. this movie song. Because we've recorded it on a VHS media.
Thank you.
got a bit limited by the idea of sine of analytic synthesis and using sine waves as a way to represent the shapes. And that's a completely musical decision, I would say. It's not really a scientific decision. Because, I mean, the project is always on the fringe of science and music, I would say. And then came the change, which I would hand the ball over to you.
Well, before maybe start jump to this control issue, it's just from this sort of experiment, we saw that the kind of environment also needs light, or it needs an interface, actually a physical interface, to kind of get all this data and parametric space. And then another question, that came up was that it's more representing the kind of sonic space or spectral shape of the sound, it's like or a sonic band, and not so much time structure or not so much kind of performance or compositional structure.
No, so that the amplitude is constant.
Yeah, so it's more kind of compositional sound, but not in time. So then came the idea that the motions should somehow represent the development of the timeline. So at least it's very brilliant, which is the claim for the environment. And decided to have a kind of physical controller that is also three-dimensional and kind of has the possibility to control three-dimensional environment.
I should say for just a little thing that happened in the sound, on the sound side, we decided to split away from using sine waves and we started using parameter synthesis instead, so we could get more interesting amplitude changes and more kind of dynamic possibilities of sound. And then, so this change actually changed also the relationship or the direct relationship. They kind of split up. So actually, then while the sound was becoming more complex, the image was becoming more complex, and slowly the relationship between the sound and the image became more complex. So right now, the environment is in such a position that you don't always tell exactly. You can't always tell if the relationship, but they still exist in a kind of subtle way. But it is also to allow more than the user of the instrument or the instrumentalist to interact with his presets by watching those clouds, which are now more resembling clouds than these resemble shapes.
I think what Tom said, that the relationship becomes more complex, and of course it's a question of mapping as well. The more interesting sound comes from more complex mapping. So the relationship is also not linear, but it's more abstract in a way. But still, kind of by performing and playing this instrument, you can kind of develop the language or the kind of gestures that you start to play with these kind of non-linear ways of control.
Mapping indeed becomes a very important issue as well. To first of all, space is infinite in this. If you just look at space as a place to put points and put presets and numbers, you can reach an infinite range. Whereas if you map it to audio, you always need to know more or less where you start and where you end. So that was the first place in which we had a lot of problems. How do we avoid having tons of infinite numbers or nano numbers? And then we started reducing ourselves and kind of putting ourselves in a rational space. And slowly we came up to a mapping which is kind of okay, kind of works. But still, I mean, mapping is really a huge issue.
It's an infinite issue.
This is an issue we're working with for about a year now, I think.
So, I mean, to go back to this control idea, so it became this time with the thoughts to have some sort of control for our environment. And we had already idea to work with the gyroscope sensor that sends rotation and use the three of them, so we can send rotation in the axis to start with. And it was on the occupation that Dan Orthoff was visiting the Spanish at the same time. And he presented a platform where he actually implemented this idea and working for tomorrow. So that gave us kind of the ability not to go so much into hardware development, which we're not experienced so much or actually haven't done before, to go and start working with the platform and see how what kind of interaction was we can get to design. But of course, it wasn't all as fantastic as we imagined, because one thing is kind of controller data, which is different, and the different issue is how do you use the data, and also like how do you map it to kind of meaningful story or kind of continuous position location. This is still kind of issue. So, but nevertheless, there are interesting ways to use it in an artistic perspective and make a range of sounds or meaningful controls.
Maybe we should switch screens.
Yeah, so just to switch screens and maybe show the interaction.
Thank you. this environment. It's quite noisy. We kind of like noisy sound. That's also a reason to stray off from sine waves. I guess for the future, we're kind of looking for a nice ball. If anybody knows the ball, we're very interested.
Or just physical design, the ball.
At the moment, the football is not the right symbol for this project because the aesthetics are kind of... well, I mean, it's nice to throw it around, but it's not really what we intend to do. I mean, phones is pretty much, would be pretty much based on the ball, but there's also some... there's a lot of meaning to the mapping and how we change and blend those different presets and map and crossfade between them and all those things. So we're still... we're still in a way looking for the right way to map this interface, I would say, to those huge amounts of this cluster of points in a meaningful way and still make it also musical at the same time. So,
Picture to a rope,
but it's also a nice thing that you can walk around freely in space and not necessarily have to, or roll the ball somewhere, not necessarily have to be connected to your gear, to your set.
Yeah, so kind of going away from the cables.
You thought about a larger ball, for instance, where this ball is inside. So
or where you're inside.
It's got to depend on you guys. I mean, if you're, I'm assuming that you're a bit seeing yourself as being the person that's more going to play this instrument, yeah? So I think it has to be something that you are comfortable playing physically. So if you don't have a relationship to playing with a ball, if you're not somebody who will stand around the street and play the ball all day, then a ball is maybe not the best thing for you. So it's maybe also a question of you to figure out what is the kind of object you're the most comfortable playing?
It's maybe also going to the ball idea, but very much because of design. Actually, we came up with the idea of sphere, just as a kind of object which is good for rotation and kind of thing going around.
So you're working in 3D and the sphere is for sure similar,
it's
a 3D
object.
Yeah. Exactly. How does it have something heavier, like a medicine ball?
Or like a metal kind of design.
I mean, just spin it on the
Actually, there was an idea to use the to use some sort of motor or gyroscope inside to give this feeling of force feedback. It would be a bit more difficult to rotate, and then you would get feeling that you can just bounce it around. You really have to move the shape.
That's
a
more flexible.
The ball is transparent.
So we're starting again. Everybody had a good lunch. There's one more presentation. Then we'll have a round table. I'm actually going to propose to have a round, not really a round table about certain subjects, but just enable people to ask questions about different presentations from today that didn't happen because we were on tight schedule. But first, Andreas Otto.
Yeah, thanks. I'm 3 minutes early, that's good.
Yeah.
Thanks for lunch. This instrument fellow talked about today, Will at Florian Grote, who is unfortunately not with me today. We worked here just a good year ago, it was in 1.5 years, in May 2005. We had to be supported by Stein. And we did a project together here from the University of Lüneburg. That's where we met, Florian and I. And Florian was fast with his studies. He finished his studies and he's working now in Berlin with Native Instruments. And so they won't let him go for a Wednesday or Monday. That's why I have to do this on my own. But it's quite interesting because yesterday we talked, in the end, in the round table, we talked about what Dan called the Renaissance man, or the opposite of Renaissance man, like musician and technician lose their all in one person. We are expected to be today, like we have to
write the software, set up your setup, and perform, and maybe do promo and write theory text about it. But Flo and I, we just did some outsourcing. Like we did a project together, and I was really the musician, I played the cello, and he was the programmer, he's doing PD job. Well, some of you do know him because he did the PD workshops here at Stein in the summer, and some of you were around here, me too, included, and needed to learn it, really get to the basics. But that's why I wouldn't be able to, or I would fail to answer the technical questions to this fellow instrument which I'm going to present. But I can say something about the concept. Well, Flo and I would both work in a work, now he's gone as I said, but we built up this audio server, which is the audio department of the University of Middleburg. Unfortunately, this is the only site which is the English information, the general information which is in English, the rest is in German because it's a German university. But if you just browse around on the homepage, you can find some info about collaborations which we have, cooperations with Stein, for example. Seminars which we are having right now, we have an online seminar together with University of Köln. Jean Lo Kim is here from there also, and Hochschule der Künste in Bern in Switzerland, with Michael Harmler, corporations there. And there's plenty of courses and workshops which we have, and it's all on topics which are also STEM related, research and similar. So this is maybe quite interesting to search. Well, we met there, and Florian moved into my house. In Lüneburg, it's a small town near Hamburg, and when his girlfriend 2 years ago made him move out, he came to my house, which is in an outside town in the forest place. So we had some really time. He came there from one day to the other, and we just met, and we didn't really meet before, but he knew I had a free room, so he came in, and then we just sat down, listened to lots of music, and he's a very technic guy, and so I was really much into listening and talking about what I hear musically, and he always had this kind of analysis ear and talked about this. So one day I came back home, and he would have set up this with a micro modular. He had a sine wave patch with 5 speakers in my living room. He said, "Well, look, I have just an audio input as a control, and if you speak into the mic or just play the cello, whatever, the system gets disturbed, and the sine waves would, like the chords would stretch." Sorry, sometimes I don't only know the German words for that moment, for this. Sometimes I may use the wrong expressions, but the chords which were in the room, they would stretch if I
expand.
If I expand, yeah.
Expand.
The pitch would lower. Yeah. If I do something loud, and this is, so it was very simple, but it was like an ambient piece, and we really enjoyed it. And we thought, well, because I met Jan Werner in the festival where I played in Vilnius, and he said, "Well, come to Stein if you have any ideas what you can do there." And then we thought, okay, let's do something with an audio input, only an audio input. Let's not use any sensors, any controlling devices, any MIDI at first we thought, but then we had to do some compromise. But let's only use the bare sound as the interface for whatever. Let's just think about this and do an application, a rough application. We applied here, I think, Robert, with this normal modular patch, and you said, we've seen this before, and that's really, but yeah, just come over and do, you have some time at the studio, and let's see what you do. So in the end, it turned out to be a completely different thing, only in PD. And we call it Fellow because it follows the cello. I played the cello, and it's just frequency analysis and amplitude and all other kinds of data which you can derive from cello playing. Another thing which I would like to say before is that I have, because I'm composing music for 5 years now, and I've put out my first album on my own label, Pingy Pong Records. So this is this window. It's a small label from Lüneburg. We work with Compact in Köln, in Cologne, which is a techno distributor. And we have a couple of releases, and this his fourth release was my first long player, which I composed in 2004. And when this came out, people asked me, well, can you play on a festival or do the show here there? And I was like, yes, I'd really love to, but it's a studio album, so how can I do this? I think everybody who knows people have the same problem. And I don't want to do these karaoke shows. I'm just playing and pretending to filter something on the mixer and doing big gestures for nothing. So I thought let's do something with my cello, but it's not just a playback. Is this a question? Or? No. Feel free to ask any questions. So this was also a goal in the head. Like maybe I can use this on stage, not only as a single instrument, but also use it with other musicians. It was one reply there. We thought, okay, I come out with an instrument which I can use for my children that I composed by the name of Schöpfingen. And also this is the album which will come out in March on the label called City Center Offices in Berlin and Manchester. And I use this fellow instrument a lot. Maybe if we have time at the end, 5 minutes, I can show a few pieces where it's just mixed inside. And also use lots of cracker boxes on the album, so it's very spam related. Okay. That's the website. I think it's also linked on the Steinberg. If you click on my name, it's this name, and you can find some info here. And links where you can download PD and this fellow patch. I think I have some printed of these. So them off later. I've printed out some, so you can take them home. Or it's easier than a bookmark. Okay. So this is the graphical interface. And as I said, the goal was just to have the sound as the mirror as the only interface of this, to avoid any controllers. So we would have frequency analysis, of course, and everybody said in advance, well, if you use fiddle, this max and PD object responsible for frequency analysis, and this wouldn't work with high pitch. There's lots of failures involved, and we said, yeah, let's just check it, and then we just like the output of what was there. It really does not work in the sense that it detects what I play on the cello, and if I have sampled the cello in this buffer, you can hit right here and buffer two samples, and then the resynthesis of the patch will work with this buffer which you have recorded. So theoretically, it could be that I play the cello and fellow plays the cello too, and you couldn't tell the difference. of course, this doesn't work. And the amplitude tracks also. And today I couldn't bring my cello because on the weekend my car died, and if I come by car from Germany, I could have brought my cello maybe, but in the train it's always bad. And on the other hand, I have this instrument which provides frequency and on and off. it's my personal bass synthesizer. It's called Mikropi. You'll soon know why. It's just on and off, and has this. That's why it's called Mikropi. It's $10 on the Berlin flea market. There's a guy selling guitar effects and these things. And this is all I need because I need this one little bit that you can hear what's happening. And I will sample this here. What I didn't mention is the spectra, which we also have. We first had this just following sample, which is synthesized by just a grain of the sample which I have. So you have the color of the sample, or a small grain of it, and resynthesize the the pitch and frequency. But it was quite boring, and we thought, okay, just let's make it more tensions, more it's more happening there, and we just added some sine waves, which is probably not the best idea. Yesterday I talked to Dan, and he said there's this Formant synthesizer in SuperCollider. Maybe using Formant would be better than just having this beefy computer music sounds. I play and I listen to the system when it responds, and the system listens to me, and it's really this interaction. I don't watch the screen again. Just you can just close the power book once it's running. You don't have to watch it, but it's listening, interfacing. that was the idea, and so it was. I think we had this big name of. Oh, where are my papers? I just had them here. But we had this interactive improvisation system or something, we call this, or improvisation instrument. So we were sitting in this composition process for this instrument. We were sitting a lot in this face in the area and talked, which was maybe the process of creativity. And then Florian would just program for 30 minutes, and then we would just play and listen and record what we play and sit down with a coffee again and talk about this. So we thought, let's also talking to Michelle and Jan Werner, and Robert was there also quite often, and getting influences from them. And so we thought, let's also derive some data from, for example, if I play long notes or if I play staccato notes, not just telling the system this is long, this is short, but having some fuzzy logic system which says, well, this is a note which I would rather call a short one, and so I will not add so many sine waves like I would if this were a rather long one. So there's not a on-off decision for long or short, like a threshold, and then it's either or, but it tends to be a long note, it tends to be a short note. And this was, if we had more time, we definitely do more things like this implement here. That if you really play with the instrument, then you learn when, oh, if I play this melody and I play it with low level and very short notes, then it sounds totally different than when I play whatever, same melody with high and long notes. Also, we had many details in this patch. We had so many ideas, we just put them all in. And for example, this the special operations in the top left, I hope you can all read it, it's quite small. It has this follow MIDI blue slider. And the idea was that you can, it's no MIDI controller yet. It's just, imagine I play the cello with a playback of my songs, which I have composed before, and I have, along with the playback in which I play this, I send MIDI notes, which are just the harmonic steps of the song. I compose songs of metrum and melodies. I like this a lot. Maybe I have to point this out in this circle here. It's not so experimental. So I would have a C, F, G, something like this, a schema, and I could tell the system which is the harmony of the current which is the current harmony of the playbill by sending a MIDI note like C. And then the spectra, which are here, these seven sine waves, which are all changing volume.
What is actually generating the variations in the spectra? Because it follows a note, so it picks up the note, but then what is actually making it change? What is making the variations?
That's right. The frequency detection has nothing to do with the change of spectra. It just says in which pitch the spectra are generated. Mm-hmm. And then it derives from amplitude and from variables like change and long or short notes. This is a whole bunch of data which comes in, mm-hmm. which if Logan were here, he would definitely love to explain this all in detail to you, but I just know how the output comes out.
He's basically mapping the data from the input in arbitrarily, well, not arbitrarily, but that is, there's not exactly. Direct relationship. Okay.
Yeah, it's mapping. It's mapping lots of data from the sound input. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But again, this mapping idea is that you only have a mic, and only what comes in through the mic or the pickup of the cello. Which is a big difference, as I explained in a minute. Only this is the data with which you communicate with the machine, and you don't have any more noise. But in the end, we had a 3D MIDI switches on the floor because I like to have this freeze thing here on top, on bottom right, have it had this freeze sample. That was the idea. What I really like it. The sound which I produce right now, and I can just push the button and it freezes and it stays like this until I push the button again. It's like this Native Instruments spectral delay or Ableton Live Reverb has this freeze button, and you can just not slow mo the sound, but it's really frozen. It's just on a small loop. I think it doesn't sound like it. I don't know exactly how this works. Well, and what John Werner said when he came in, you have to add more feedback to the system. That's what it needs to be rock and roll. Come on, do some more feedback. It sounds too bleaky. And we thought, okay, what's feedback in the system? And then we just had this very simple idea: if audio is the only interface, what comes in through the mic, then the feedback, a regular feedback. If I may ask you to push this, this type of music. An idle here. It's a control kind of feedback because it's analyzing the output of the speaker, and if it adds some noise and spectra to it, maybe it just gets the one pitch because it's monophonic. Of course, you can only detect one single frequency. Maybe it detects one pitch which is not the bass frequency, which I was wanting to. That is normal. Yeah.
System has intimidated you to perform with it in public. Have other people played with it? Because often one learns a lot from one's own system when somebody else.
Like an effect machine, which adds some atmosphere to the thing.
always some other thing. Octave one is beds. Octave two is this buffer thing where I just scrub around. Three is percussion, and four is melody.
Don't you need like should be clown or that you have
this fits time? In my suitcase.
Okay.
And everybody's on their own channel. So
yeah.
That's it. I don't have to do, because I route them all into the mixer, I don't have to do any popping up and down with a particular person.
That probably helps also if you have a conductor who also guides you partly in what's going on. Because I tend to.
He leaves me. I and one of the percussionists are sort of free agents that can do almost whatever we want.
But then you probably also tend to sample certain people more than others because they.
Because certain people always consistently play remarkable things.
Yeah.
That's true.
Yeah. Or about a sample, because
yeah. We used to have a harp, and she, God, the stuff she improvised was just gorgeous. Yeah.
And see, does that mean if somebody's playing something rhythmic and they play a bar, and they play a bar, and they play a bar, can you catch that bar and then play it back as a bar?
That's very rare in this band. If anyone is playing something that regular, it's more likely to be an odd meter, and perhaps the percussionist, but he's very melodic player.
Right.
Only if Dino cymbals a groove will he do that. And Lisa is extremely responsive. I can nail the... Absolutely. It's easy. Yeah, Lisa is right on.
But that's really a practice thing, isn't it? Practice
yeah, actually my groove.
I'm a musician, you know, so I have, since 4 years old, been dealing with rhythm, so I can hit on a downbeat. That's all I need.
Or not on it, or it tracks my hand movement or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's really hard for me to play in a relaxed fashion like I play when I just have my instrument. And so I always had this solution just to have a look at the sound in terms of data. And I would like to see you play or have whether it's really an extension for you or how if it's a totally different. I also do, in fact, there are some videos online as well. If I don't get a chance, you can see, for instance, the piece that I mentioned, my friend John Thompson wrote for me. I think that's on his website. I might have a link to it. But you can find it online, it's called Sonofusion. Sonofusion, one word.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, the general approach, I actually will never stop playing an acoustic violin either. So I understand
but it's two different things. So
they're totally different things, and at the same time, I'm completely actually. Yeah, the point of. Like, I actually wouldn't want to just tack sensors onto, say, and I did, of course, in the process of experimenting, and I owned a. Still have it somewhere stored away, an old Zeta electric violin.
Mm-hmm.
And then throw sensors on that and try to. I would have wanted to perform with that. Because it never would have felt like it was finished enough to get on stage with it. I mean, you could attach things permanently too, but for some reason I wanted to have an instrument that was complete and thought of as an actual instrument in and of itself, rather than, you know, okay, well then I can just... Because if you do that, at least my own take on it is that if I add sensors to the Zeta, or whatever you have, even just an acoustic instrument to start with, you put a few sensors on it, it can always evolve much almost too fast. Instead of like with Michel, just hands stopping. And now I'm gonna learn to play this is an instrument and you have to like practice that.
But you can do the same with if you add sensors to
like
a violin at a certain moment you say, well this is a set I wanna learn to work.
No, there's nothing, actually you're right, there's nothing stopping that.
Then another person is getting concentrated on another aspect, even if we all of us do kind of a bit of everything, but not really.
So you have different in some projects, people have different roles?
I mean, most of the time we have different roles, really. For instance, Lidwin tends to be our performer, because she's the one who has an instrument playing classical formation, you know, classical background. I tend to do the pure data programming because I do it faster than other people. The networking aspect and so on, all that kind of stuff is really Jerome's domain. The kind of critical writing feedback side tends to be Esther. So, I mean, we, you know, and this is one of our ideas is to really have people working on a common project, but who can tackle it from a different angle and have a different.
So, what if, for example, you get carried away with a PD patch and make it much too beautiful or much too special, while others think, well, just it's finished now, it's working, so don't spend any more time on it. Does that happen?
Well, I've also got things to do when it's gone past. I know that problem because I also perform.
But if you have. I think when I each day you make noise, then you don't see where you are anymore.
Yeah.
But when you do different things, or when you visit your website, and then you try, hey, can I play somewhere? And then, so each day is different, and then you keep yourself sort of sharp.
Okay.
Can I make more 10 hours, or is it efficient or not?
Yeah.
So as a piano player, I spend a lot of time just playing piano, and then. I've been doing quite a lot of PD recently as well, and time seems to have a different meaning when you're doing PD. Suddenly, like 9 hours has gone by, you know, that's a lot of time at the piano. But just as we speak about it now, it occurs to me that because it's mainly jazz stuff that I'm doing, I'm trying to understand the chords relate and how the scales relate to the chords and whether there's a difference. And in a way, it's like programming PD. It's like programming PD up here. There's a network in my brain that understands what a major chord is, and it relates to a certain kind of rhythm in a certain way, and by making connections between those two parts of my nervous system. It's like two little bits of a mouse patch or a PD patch. So perhaps the two processes aren't really that far apart, actually. Perhaps really, when you program a computer, you're really programming yourself. And when you play like a violin, you know, you've got to work out where your finger is, you know, and how much you move your finger, and whether you can move that at the same speed every time, you know, and whether it's really in pitch, you know. Perhaps it's the same thing, and it's all the same thing. I'll get a bit scared now,
actually. There's the latest, I think it's the latest issue.
But regardless of this futuristic idealism, I think learning the process of constantly fixing your setup or your system or the problems that arise from unfinished things, to me it practically becomes a lifestyle in itself, or sort of instrumentalism. So the programming and the playing and the presentation are never finished in a way. And I have a feeling that it becomes an aesthetic in itself, like this noisiness. So that